the pyramids have risen up out of the sands of Egypt as a proud testament to the nature of human achievement. They are both monuments to that which endures and to that which fades away. Their original grandeur has been sandblasted by time, but these man-made mountains, the product of many thousands of hours of sweat and blood, now stand as fixed points in the North African landscape. They are as natural a part of it as the desert plains, the mountains, or the great River Nile. Modern Egypt is very far removed from the ancient nation of the pyramid builders, but still her pyramids form a focus for national pride and identity. They're a legacy which has been handed down to the Egyptians from ancestors who believed in multiple gods and whose government was imposed by ruling dynasties. The great rulers of these dynasties were the Egyptian pharaohs, the creators of the pyramids.
Anyone who has visited Egypt will have visited the pyramids. And the sheer size immediately fills you with such awe that you begin to want to find out more, I think.
The pyramids and the Sphinx are the symbols of Egyptian culture more than any other. If you want to invoke the culture of ancient Egypt, you stick a picture of the pyramids or the Sphinx on it, and it automatically calls up all those associations.
Well, one thing worth bearing in mind is up until the early part of this century, the Great Pyramid at Giza was the tallest building ever created by mankind, and still, for sheer mass of stone, it's the most massive building ever created, which is fairly amazing, given it's one of the earliest buildings of mankind.
When the first pyramid was built, Western Europe was still shrouded in the mists of prehistory. Stonehenge would not be built for another 500 years or more. Civilization grew in Egypt, as it would elsewhere, on the banks of a river, the Nile, the great life provider in an otherwise hostile environment. The Egyptians considered the river to be a god, and that it was Khnum, the god of creation, who caused the river to swell. The south of Egypt was as arid as it is today. But in the north, where the land was low, lay the wide delta of the Nile, which was cool and marshy. After the river had flooded and receded, the land would be left covered by mud washed down from the African interior. The whole of the Nile Valley would then become fertile.
The Nile, I think we can say, was the lifeline for the ancient Egyptians. It was the fact that the Nile flooded every year that meant that the ancient Egyptians had fertile land. And this fertile land enabled them to pretty much every year grow a good enough crop to then feed the people. And if it hadn't been for that annual flooding of the Nile and the new deposit of thick black Nile silt that was laid down each year, then the ancient Egyptians just would not have been able to feed their population.
Egyptian farmers could then grow crops such as wheat, barley and fruit, as well as papyrus reeds, from which they made paper. Papyrus was perhaps the single most important crop as far as the creation of a civilization was concerned. The Egyptians had developed a written language by 3000 BC. The chief minister of the land, under the pharaoh, was also the agriculture minister, which reveals what an important role crops played in Egyptian life. Centuries later, when Egypt was an eastern province of the Roman Empire, it was as an area of arable production that it was most valued. It was cultivation of the land that led to other forms of cultivation. The organization of food production allowed time and manpower for the development of writing, arts, and building, and in turn, a highly advanced civilization. The cradle of Egyptian civilization was founded on the Nile's regular flooding and ability to sustain life.
The Nile provides all kinds of things. First of all, it's the highway of Egypt. Egypt itself really is constrained to the narrow territory on either side of the Nile, so therefore all transport really could go along there. It also meant that it also was the source of food, fish and so on comes from there. And the inundation, the annual flooding of the Nile, was the whole base of the agriculture of Egypt. So without the Nile, there would not have been an Egypt. There still wouldn't be an Egypt.
But this culture, which relied so much upon the life given by the Nile, was also one which was very much preoccupied with death.